Okay, so thank you everyone for coming along to our session, My Tube, Your Face. And so we're going to have a look at how social networks and online media can be used from, I suppose, the documentary filmmaker's perspective to leverage audiences and, you know, kind of with broadcast audiences kind of trickling away at a rather alarming speed. It's important that we have a look at how online can be used for filmmakers and for independents. But luckily for you, I'm not doing this by myself. We have with us a fantastic panel. On my right here, we have Brian Hill, who is managing director of Century Films and is a veteran filmmaker with over 60 films that he's made for the various broadcasters, BBC, ITV, Channel 4. Also, through his work with poet Simon Armitage, has developed a new form of documentary, the documentary musical in pieces that you may have seen, such as Fulton Sings. So, glad to have him on the panel. We've also got Richard Thompson, who is operations director of Endemol for digital media. He has basically, through his work at Endemol, created various online series. There's a series called The Cell, series 1 and 2, that he's done for O2 and Sony Pictures International. The Gap Year, which went out for Bebo, which is something that you may have all heard about. Along with that, he's also done original drama for MSN, which I believe is going to be the first sci-fi interactive drama, so maybe you can talk about that some when we get through to that, and as well as producing online elements for programs such as Big Brother, Deal or No Deal, and Gox Fashion Fix. Also here on my left here, we have Gavro, who from director from Big Balls Films, fantastic name there. Gav, you must probably know his work mainly for the fantastic and groundbreaking stuff he did on Kate Modern, which I'm sure is something that everybody here has heard of. And so we'll definitely be diving into that. He's also, those guys over at Big Ball Films are also kind of working with the Mail on Sunday at MySpace for a commissioned drama called I Love Chieftown, which I'm sure we'll get into. And then finally, and not least, Daniel Hewitt, okay, who is here representing Bebo, who I've already mentioned several times because of the work that has come from other people here on the panel here. And so his role at Bebo, is talking about, is looking at taking partnerships that will transform the way people interact with media and leveraging the obviously massive audience that they have on Bebo and transforming those into eyeballs on film. Okay, so look, when it comes to social networks, a lot of people, what's the view that we have of social networks? The majority view, I suppose, is that it's all about vampire apps and, if you're lucky, Scrabulous, that hasn't been pulled yet. And it's not necessarily the immediate thing that you think of when you think about finding an audience for your films, okay? So look, let's just have a look. I've got a clip here, which I think quite well expresses that view of that people have of social networks. So let's just use this as a jumping off point, and then we will dive into our discussion. Okay.
Edward Baxter! It's me, Todd from school!
Oh.
We sat next to each other in maths. We didn't get on, remember?
Yeah.
Do you want to be my friend?
What?
Do you want to be my friend, confirm or ignore?
All right.
Great. Where did we meet?
You know where we met.
Do you want to skip this step?
We met at school.
Okay, but how about if we say we met on an oil rig and we were lovers for 50 years?
That's not true.
It's a joke. It's like a really brilliant joke. Can I get confirmation on that, please?
No.
Can I get confirmation on that, please?
No.
Okay, are you in a relationship?
I've got to.
Is it complicated? It's complicated. Okay, what are you looking for? Friendship, dating, whatever you can get. Let's just say random play, because that could mean anything, like really, really kinky, horrible.
What's he doing?
Writing on your wall.
I've written, all right, Eddie, you dickhead.
Everyone can see it. Okay, I've got some photos of you on our school trip to Paris, and you're in the bath, and you're covered in urine and sick. And I've written a caption, and I'm like, nice one, Eddie. That was my puke and piss.
And mine.
Can I have those? Now that we're friends, I can show this to all your other friends, all your real friends in your proper life, like your friends from work and your potential girlfriends. Are you friends with your mum?
Well, yeah, of course I am.
Status update! Todd is poking Eddie's mum and he's showing her the picture of the puke and the piss. Anyone for Scrabble?
Okay, so look, that is, I think, the general view of what social networks are all about, okay? But there's obviously a lot more to them. And when you've got an audience that is as large as that, it doesn't make sense to not try and bring them to your films, okay? So look, just to throw out some figures there, you know, the British interactive TV market, the Observer said in August of this year in a piece, could be reaching revenues of somewhere in the region of 1.78 billion by 2011, which is obviously a really big deal and something that you guys as creators all want to tap into. Okay, so, you know, now we're at a stage where, you know, there's hardly anyone on dial-up. We've got a lot, you know, we've got faster connections. So, you know, actually watching programs from online is a reality now. So social networking sites, some of them have already started to exploit this market with shows such as Kate Modern or The Gap Year, which we're going to come to. So we are, with this amount of audience, this amount of eyeballs, you know, how can we as documentary filmmakers exploit that? And so I want to turn to Danel first, okay, of Bebo, to really ask you, you know, in 2007, Bebo kind of opened the doors to media partners, large media partners such as CBS and MTV.
Large and small.
All right, well, sorry, okay, large and small.
Any content creator, in fact.
Okay, and so I suppose kind of, you know, to start off, what was the strategy behind that and, you know, kind of how did you see leveraging your audience and bringing those guys in?
Yeah, apologies to anyone, the last panel I'm just going to completely repeat myself. you're right, about a year ago something dramatic happened on Bebo, and generally in the online space with the announcement we made. Bebo is a social network, so it lives in the same space as MySpace and Facebook. There are an incredibly large number of people on Bebo, 42 million users around the world. In the UK, there are approximately 11.2 million young people who come to the site every month. The core demographic is 13 to 24. And a year, just over a year ago, we had a really in-depth look at the site to try and understand, you know, what were the reasons for all of these people coming to Bebo, and secondly, why were they spending so much time on Bebo? Up to 40 minutes on Bebo per session. And video was key to that. It was driving a lot of this engagement to the point that we were responsible for close to a billion videos being consumed on Bebo every month. But there was a funny dynamic going, because all those videos were cats and dogs and, you know, the typical UGC laughing babies and things like that. There was no real rights owned content or traditional sort of commissioned storytelling. We decided to create this platform, open media, with a simple message to any rights owner, any content creator. You can come to Bebo, you can bring your content, engage with our audience, set up a channel, bring whichever player you choose to bring. So I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with the different types of video technology out there. They work on Bebo. You can bring advertising as well through that player and around and within that content. And actually, you can keep 100% of the revenue. So we kind of remove all the barriers that rights owners and media publisher broadcasters have in the space online at the moment, which is mainly around control. We want you to retain control of your content. It's not really up to us to say what our users should be seeing. And at the same time, we also decided to have a bit of fun and commission some content. So we met two guys from America, Miles and Greg, who had created something pretty amazing called Learning Off of Fini. I won't talk too much about it. And that spurred on some really interesting projects, which you'll see shortly. But I want to show you something really quickly. Can I just show the message from Earth? And this is a project that lives on that open media platform. So this is something that we didn't commission, that came to us. We're simply the platform, the promotion, and the audience. So
Hi, Hi, I'm Alice.
I'm James.
And today, Bebo is creating history. We're sending a digital time capsule 120 trillion miles into deep space from the very telescope we're sitting in now.
Our destination is Gliese 581c, the nearest planet to Earth that could hold life. Welcome to A Message from Earth.
Out of more than 8,000 picture and written messages sent in by Bebo users, 500 were chosen.
From a favourite place to an inspiring person, these messages create an exciting snapshot of life on Earth.
And it's not just Bebo users that wanted the chance to have their voices heard in space.
A galaxy of stars have also shared their snapshots of life on Earth.
Hello, this is Patrick Moore.
Hey, my name's Gok Kwan.
I'm Deborah Meaden from Dragon's Den.
Hello, I'm Tom Furlow.
Hi, we are Alpha Bead.
Hello, aliens. I'm Scott Mills off of Earth.
Picture of Bush and a picture of Obama right next to each other.
What does that mean? What does that say?
Big breast.
Probably show him a few moves.
Exciting.
A Beatles song, something like that.
I'm melting. Dollar bill.
That's a good one, isn't it?
I think I'd be upset without baked beans.
I would love to see an Earth that just says everybody's cycling.
Send some love as well.
The Launchpad Show has been the weekly definitive guide to anything and everything you could want to know about our message.
Hosted by us, Launchpad presents all the best bits from A Message from Earth. Cue montage.
Hi.
Ho. Hi ho. My name is James.
And my name is Alan.
Welcome to
The Launchpad Show.
Well, that is its name.
And I am so excited.
A Message from Earth is very proud to announce that we've reached the 1,000 submission mark.
Ever since my pick was posted first, I've been handing out autographs, I've been gagged on by the paparazzi.
Danny for president!
It's now time for the part of the show that is to Bebo users what the Oscars are to George Clooney. It's the Wall of Fame.
I think this is really good. I think it should go on the Wall of Fame.
You're going on the wall.
Sweating like a pig.
In Disneyland Paris.
I can't believe it. That's totally in mainland Europe.
I know, jealous. Novelty high five.
I think that's a good note to end on.
Done.
All of this leads us on to the most important people in this project, the Bebo users.
They've taken full advantage of this opportunity using our application to upload photos, draw pictures and write messages.
The result is something truly unique.
Hi, I'm Avan and this is my message from Earth.
It's a picture that symbolises war.
A football with the different aspects of football around it.
It's Earth on a matchstick and it's burning.
It's just a really good example of just escaping for a weekend.
I think it shows the beauty of this world and it's not just all about war and hate.
It shows how the world is today, that footage and money is more important than actually helping people.
So it's official, the messages have been transmitted into deep space and in 1.7 seconds they've already passed the moon.
It's been an epic journey, but for the messages, the journey has only just begun. Thanks for joining us.
Goodbye.
So, completely mad idea that the RDF came to us with, and we were just like, you know, you're insane. What is this thing that you're trying to do? Because we don't come up with any of these ideas. You know, the people you see sitting here and you guys out there kind of come up with these amazing concepts. So there's two things going on around content on Bebo. One is us kind of commissioning, and we'll aim to do maybe sort of eight or nine of those next year. But they're all brand funded, so the shows are paid for by sponsors with brand integration, which is really interesting, a kind of a new model and something that we're all kind of experimenting with and learning as we go because it's so new. And then the other model, the other platform is open media, where any rights owner, content creator can come to Bebo and say, look, I've got an idea for a show. It can be big, it can be small, it can be simply kind of like video blogging or telling a short story. And what we'll try to do is get behind you and push it out to our users, get an audience there around it. And look, if it seems like it's doing well and it's relevant for brand sponsorship, then you know, we'll try to support you as best we can to take it out there. Yeah, it's kind of a snapshot, yeah.
Okay. You know, given that, today I was reading before the session started that ITV have said that their ad revenue forecast for the fourth quarter are down 9% year on year, and that seems to be a trend that's continuing, kind of onwards. Do you see yourselves at Bebo as the new broadcasters, the new commissioners Is that your place? Are you replacing the old guard, would you say?
No, I don't think so at all. In fact, you know, we work very closely with the large broadcasters. They work on this open media platform as well. BBC, Channel 4 and ITV all carry open media channels on Bebo, and I think there's an amazing opportunity for them to kind of really be the guardians of great content. We're not content creators. Bebo's a technology platform, and you know, we shouldn't really push too hard to become commissioners. You guys understand content and understand who that content is for, and if that content happens to be for the Bebo demographic, then that's wonderful.
Okay, so Gav, as someone who has created, you know, very successful media for online with Kate Modern, I'd like to talk us through that a bit, and talk us, I suppose, maybe about the process of being commissioned for something online, and, you know, how mature it is now. How much do the commissioners, either traditional or people, you know, from Bebo and places like that, how much they understand the space and the things that you have to do around that content, as well as, you know, as opposed to just pushing it out at 9 o'clock on ITV, as, you know, was the case.
As well, I should mention at this point, I wasn't actually the creator of Kate Modern. Luckily enough, I met Miles and Greg when they were over here looking for somebody to direct their show. We took them out, showed them a good time. They gave us a job. I wouldn't say, I think backing up, and I think going somewhat to answer your question as well, it's what's really interesting about working with social networks and getting stuff commissioned on social networks, for me, is it gives me a different way of telling a story, and it also allows me a never-before-seen kind of relationship with the audience that I'm trying to push something out to. I mean, and I think that's something that Bebo have got a very, very good handle on, and I think a lot of the other social networks are going to be trying to catch them up, because it's that information, what their viewers like, what their viewers don't like, how their viewers react, what opinions their viewers have on certain subject matter that goes on in the films that you create for these social networking sites is important, both for a brand when they're working with a site or giving you money to actually commission a show. And as a filmmaker, it gives you a very rare insight into what your audience is really feeling. I mean, on Kate Modern, we were a live show, so we reacted to that audience quite a lot. I think, what was the phrase that you used earlier? The crazy hecticness, shit fight probably, that was Kate Modern in the early days when we didn't actually have scripts and we'd already started shooting. So, you know, you are making bespoke entertainment, I suppose, for an audience that's out there, and hopefully that audience will come along the ride with you. Which, I'm a drama filmmaker now, but I would imagine that would be extremely useful for documentary filmmakers to have that insight into what that audience is thinking.
Mm-hmm. Okay, shall we? You've got a clip here from Kate Modern, so shall
yeah,
we?
Kate Modern was really successful in the way that it was. I mean, we were getting, they say, 1.5 million viewers in our heyday, and a total of 56 million over our first series. So that's a lot of people reacting and having an opinion on the things that you're making, I suppose, which is scary at sometimes and quite pleasurable at others.
We always put a frame around everything. It's how we make sense of things. Delineating things. It's useful, but it causes a lot of problems. Everything has a beginning and an end.
Kate!
He wore black and I wore white. He would always win the fight. Bang, bang, he shot me down. Bang, bang, I hit the ground. Bang, bang, that awful sound. Bang, bang, my baby shot me down. Down, 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 shot you down, bang, bang. You hit the ground, bang, bang. That awful sound, bang, bang. I used to shoot you down.
Okay. Okay, so look, we're obviously here at DocFest, which is documentary focused, and the examples that we've spoken about so far haven't been documentary, they've been, you know, kind of like fiction-based pieces. And so I'd like to turn to you, Richard,
sure,
to talk about factual content and therefore the work that you guys have done with the gap year. So can you talk about, I suppose, how that developed and...
Well, I think, like everyone else, last year we were blown away by Cape Martin. You look at it and just go, how different, how refreshing, how extraordinary the opportunities afforded by this platform that a viewer stroke user, whatever, can actually email or comment directly both on the storyline but also send a comment directly to the character. And you go, well, that's fantastic, and you can actually influence the plot that way. You can warn them of what's going to happen. You can warn them what someone else is going to do. And we thought, well, that's awesome, really. And if you apply factual sensibilities to that, what can you come up with? So we came up with the idea of the gap here, which was very specifically geared towards Bebo. It's geared towards a younger demographic. We, in this country, all know what a gap year is. Bebo wanted something that showcased their then six territories, Australia, New Zealand, North America, Canada, UK and Ireland. So we came up with the idea that we will audition for and cast, to use a fiction term, six travellers, from each of those territories, and send them on a six-month gap year with a producer-director who will film them on a small camera, edit and upload a film about each of those travellers every week. So, six travellers. On the seventh day, we did a roundup show, so you could tune in, you could go on the site every Sunday and see what happened during the week, or it went live at midday every day. It went up on the 20th of May, and it comes to an end at the end of next week, so it's been up for 24 weeks. And every single day, a new video. It's done very well. We used the same commercial model that Cape Martin had perfected, which was to, with our sales team and Bebo's sales team, was to go to advertisers and say, here's an opportunity to reach a very specific demographic of young people around the world. This is their first global project for Bebo, original project. And we had some advertisers from Australia. We had one advertiser from North America, not as many as we wanted, and most of the advertisers came from the UK. And we worked with product integrations, which I know is a whole new area, and particularly coming from a world of factual production, you kind of go, ooh, product placement, no, thank you very much, I don't want anything to do with it. If you're clever, you make it work for you. Our most successful advertisers, sponsors, whatever you want to call them, are things that seamlessly integrate. Tourism Australia, how hard is that? Send the kids to Australia, great, tick. You know, Tourism Auckland, the RAF, you know, you can come up with some really, really interesting things that it's not going product, ooh, I feel better for drinking my ice water nonsense. It's taking brand messages and just having fun with it. And the great thing about a younger demographic is they want to have fun. So the point is, we took, you know, many, many years worth of programming experience and went, what actually happens when you send six kids around the world with one other person? You know, what is your duty of care? What are the health and safety implications? What happens? What do you pay for? What don't you pay for? What happens if they all get killed on the first week? What happens? What happens? What happens? And you go, whoa, you know, if you don't apply what we've all done over the years, everyone in this room, the experience you have of, you know, we've been sending crews around the world for decades, you know, you apply the same principles, but it's just for a different audience and you're doing it on a lot less money. And it's a lot of fun. And it's got a loyal audience. You know, the views, we're very impressed with the number of views. Bebo are happy with them. You know, talking about a second series, you know, it's kind of, mm-hmm. It's good. Mm-hmm. It works, and it works because it's, I think, engaging content that is geared towards the specific demographic using the unique characteristics of the platform. And by that I mean, you know, you can go onto the show page to watch it, you can move the videos onto your profile page, you can engage with the sponsor's profile page, you can engage with the traveller's profile page, you can engage with the PD's profile page. There's massive amounts of kind of interaction around what is a brand, but it's also a show. So people, whether they're talking about a sponsor's competition, whether they're talking about, I can't believe you snogged that bloke in Bali, it's all the same thing, and everyone's just having a good chat around it. And I think that it's something that, you know, we should all think about, not be wary of the internet, not be wary of social networking, and not say, you know, you can't just take a 52-minute documentary and put it on YouTube and expect everyone to watch it, but you can apply some of the characteristics of these platforms to what we're already doing, what you're already doing, and there is more synergy than you think. Mm-hmm. Do you want to have a quick...
Yeah,
there's just... Okay. This was... I didn't go through and do best bits. I took a week, and this was just to show you where they all were. This was 1 week, a couple of weeks ago, and there's just a short bit of each of the six.
You get that up.
In Australia, if you wear Speedos, you will get beaten up, basically, by your mates. It's like, come on, mate, are you serious?
So then we decided to see Rio the VIP way in a helicopter, and that was such a cool experience. I love it so, so, so much. I just don't want to leave. I just want to stay here forever.
Having just left Mexico, Lewis's American adventure begins in Miami.
The hostel that we're staying in is a jazz hostel, which has also got a good atmosphere. A lot of young people here, which is great. Went on a bit of a pub crawl on our first night here.
I've come to Wet Willie's. That's the name of the place. Drinking age is 21, and I'm happy that I'm 23 years old. Thank you.
Some crocodiles were reported out in the swamp. Got on our bare feet and walked into the swamp. And you're looking around, it's pitch dark. You don't even know if there's a crocodile right there.
I just want to tell you now, out here, Dave, this crocodile's got the worst reputation for human tragedy of any of the 24 species in the world.
I was a bit scared and apprehensive of the whole thing, but luckily we didn't encounter any crocodiles, which is always good. The following day, we got a little tour around the farms.
Big male over here, he's a lump, he's 3/4 of a ton. So his name is Boss Hogg.
After our little tour, we were like straight into the pen. All these angry crocodiles looking at me like they were gonna eat me or something. And I was like, you having a laugh?
After many recommendations from everyone all over Byron Bay, we've booked onto Jim's tour. However, our tour guide is Dougie. And he is quite eccentric, but really friendly, charismatic character.
And there we were, pubescent boys naked on the streets for half the night, eh? These are life-changing experiences.
I think we're in for a very entertaining day.
We're travelling in the second oldest bus still on service in the Byron Shire. And of course, not to mention your ageing hippie bus driver. Just how many brain cells have I retained for this position? Who knows? Who can tell?
Me and diving is kind of like oil and water at the moment. When I was in Egypt, I just let it get the most of me. I had a panic. It was just like... It was a mixture of like being annoyed because I was just like, what the hell? Why can't I just do this? I feel good. I feel like I wouldn't be suiting up. Didn't want to do this, so. Just wanted a good dive. The whole thing all together was an accomplishment. At the beginning, I was so, so nervous. The more and more I'm getting into it, which is what, only by my third time, I'm a little more confident now. And it was patting myself on the back. Great job, Kara.
She did absolutely brilliantly. And obviously, we're really chuffed with that, you know? We're really chuffed. So well done, Kara.
I am now a certified open water diver.
God. Oh. Oh, look at him. Look at all the bears. Oh my God. Basically, they rescue them and take them from poachers. Poachers take them for like Chinese medicine for like their bile in their stomach and stuff. Yeah, it's not good. But this is good.
I know you've also got a video which is kind of like a site walkthrough.
Yeah, if anyone's interested, I mean, it's quite short, but I think, as I was mentioning earlier on, the engagement with the content, I think, is particularly important. And if you haven't seen the site, it might be worth just, it takes about a minute, and I'll just talk you through it. So if you should just play. So that is the profile page. So it's got a video view at the top. As you scroll down the page, there are pictures of the sponsors on the right, and on the left, you've got the individual travelers. You click on any of those, we'll go straight through to their profile page. On the right, those are our sponsors. You click on any of them, goes through to their pages. Then if we scroll down, the next thing you'll see is the current competition. We're doing a poll on the left-hand side, again, engagement, encouraging people to say, what do you think about this, what do you think about that? This company here had given us these secure backpacks, and they wanted to run a competition to win one. So, and then we scroll down again. These are the results of the last poll that we did. It's all fun, but kids love it. They love voting. Down here, this is quite important, the gap year map, which I'm going to come back to in just a second, because that serves a number of purposes. Scroll down, and then those are our producer directors. So those are the guys traveling with our travelers. You click on those, go through to their pages. Down here, these are all the usual comments you'd expect on a social network. So they're commenting on competitions, they're commenting on sponsors, they're commenting on, and on the left there, we've got the friends. But they're commenting on things that are happening. I think it just goes back up again to the map. We developed the map as an archiving device, because if you're putting up a new video every day, you kind of, how do I go back to the one that was in Sumatra? I don't know. But we come up with this map so you can click on a traveler. So there we go. There's Amy. That's where she is now. There are links on that dialogue box that take you through to her current blog, her current video, whatever. And you can trace her journey back. And anywhere else you click will go back to where they were. So there's Andre in Goa. That's where he is now. But if you go back to when he was in Japan on the right, you click on that, that'll come up. This is what I did when I was in Kyoto. And that takes you straight through to the video that could have been put up 3 months ago, could have been put up yesterday. So it's an interesting navigation tool, because I think the problem with these kind of projects is you're creating so much content. It's going fresh every day. How do you back reference? The point is it's going to be up there forever. You know, it is, we want people to carry on watching it. We want people to go back and go, I'm going to Kyoto, go in there and have a look at that and see what his particular experiences and adventures were, and see if they can learn and comment from it. So that's the site.
Okay, so I want to pick on something you just said there. The material is going to be up there forever. And obviously you make sponsorship.
Ask him, yeah. Is it?
Well, forever. Well, actually this could go out to both of you. You make sponsorship deals, okay? But, you know, in the imperfect world that we live in, those sponsorship deals sometimes break down and don't last as long as your content's going to last. So what happens in situations like that if there was a relationship you had with the sponsor that then kind of went away?
That's fine. The sponsor stays with that content for the lifetime of that content being up on the web, and you know, Endemol can control the content so they can take it down whenever they want. But you know, I think they're right. It'll stay up there as a resource and hopefully feed into series two.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, one of the things that I think filmmakers think of when they think of online and working online is the fact of the gatekeepers aren't there. And I think the projects that we've spoken about so far, it's going through, you know, going through Bebo, going through Endemol and being commissioned to do this. And so I want to come to you and talk about your experience, and especially with your project on Village People and what happened around that and what happened with that.
Well, we can see a clip from it shortly, but it's basically a project where I've got a friend in New York, and he's English. He'd recently moved to New York from Sydney, and he's quite wealthy, and he was a big shot in advertising. And he had a kind of life crisis and thought, when he got to New York, that he didn't want to really be a big shot in advertising anymore. And he and his wife had bought this crumbling house in West Greenwich Village. And having bought it, which cost a fortune, they needed to renovate it, and they needed an income coming in, and he didn't really want to work in advertising, and there was this tension between him and his wife, who wanted him to go out and earn the salary. And we got talking, and we thought we might try and do something quite interesting with a film. We thought we might try and do something which pushed at the boundaries between drama and documentary, that was somehow rooted in documentary, but kind of explored ways of being fictionalised as well. And we called it Village People, and it was basically about the restoration of this house, and that was really happening. They were restoring this house, and he did meet real people along the way, and a number of characters who became fixtures in his life. And what happened was that I went over, self-funded, to New York and shot a pilot with him for a couple of days. And one of the things that was interesting was that having a camera there gave him the license to say the kind of things that he wouldn't say, you know, in normal social situations, because we're all limited by our upbringing and the social mores that we kind of live by. So he could go and talk to these characters and say kind of sometimes fairly outrageous things because the camera was there and it was all, yeah, well, this is for a film. Anyway, we shot, and I didn't really know what I was going to do with this. And we took it to HBO, who almost commissioned it, but they thought it was too much like Curb Your Enthusiasm and they didn't want another one of those. We took it to the BBC, and I knew that we'd have problems because people didn't really get it. You know, it's like, what is it, drama or documentary? And so, well, it's kind of a mixture of both. And the BBC were keen at one point, Channel 4 were keen at one point, but they weren't quite keen enough. And so I thought, I've got this material, what am I going to do with it? So we chopped it into 3-minute sections and stuck it on YouTube. And people started watching it, and people were sending comments in, and people liked it. I then got a call from somebody who'd seen it, who had money, who said, I think this is brilliant. It's fantastic. You should be making these into kind of full-length episodes. And I said, yes, that's absolutely what we'd like to do. And this person said, well, I'll fund it. I'll fund you to go and make 6 half-hour films. And then we own them between us. We own them. No commissioning editors, no broadcasters, no nobody at all, just us. And we can do what we want, no gatekeepers. Which seemed really liberating. And so we kind of made plans to do this. And then something called a recession came along. And basically the guy with the money pulled out. But I found somebody else who's prepared to fund it. So we're continuing to make it. And I don't know what we'll do with it in the end. I don't know whether we'll try and sell it to broadcasters, whether we'll talk to Bebo about it. You know, I don't know what we'll do with it. But the idea that we can, and we're going to make them really on the cheap. They're not like fully funded broadcaster rights. But the idea that we can go make these films with no controls and nobody looking over our shoulder and no commissioning editors come and have their sometimes less than helpful input is really fantastic. And this is, we'll just have a look at a clip from it.
My name's Simon Collins, and I'm a creative director in advertising, and I recently moved to New York with my family, my wife and my 2 small children. My wife's called Roberta, and she's American, and my children are called respectively Chester, who's 9 years old, and Ruth Riley, who's just turned 8 years old. So look at that. I'm not even sure that's a dog. I don't think that's a dog. It's one of the few negatives I would say about Greenwich Village is the high incidence of dog stuff on the pavements. And I know that most people are responsible and use little plastic bags to pick it up and take it somewhere, but you know, I do seem to step in it a lot, and of course that's a problem.
I got an interview, by the way.
Oh, good. Where?
I don't know yet. The headhunter's going to call.
Okay, fantastic.
Doesn't sound like a great job.
Well, you know, you get a job. It's easy to find a job when you have a job. You know.
Yeah, but I don't. You know, it's got to be. It's going to be the right job. I mean, you know, there's going to be a lot of job offers.
The point is to try and get at least a job.
I think you're underestimating how much in demand my skills are, my abilities are.
And I'm sure you are. I'm sure you are.
Well, you don't sound like you. You don't sound like you have a huge amount of confidence.
Hey, good morning.
I've seen you around here quite a bit. My name's Simon.
How are you? I'm Ed.
How'd you do, Ed?
I've just moved into the neighbourhood. I live actually just around in the apartment, just around the corner there. We rent an apartment there, my wife and our two children, but we're actually renovating a house.
Oh, really?
Do you know Grove Street?
Of course.
Do you know anything about building?
Oh, yeah.
How do you mean?
I'm 64 now, so I'm like not doing too much, but I'm a mason by trade.
And are you working at the moment?
No, I'm not. I could use work, too.
Could you? You know what? It's funny to say that.
But the funny thing is I'm not well these days, so one of the main reasons why I don't take a full-time job is because I can't guarantee I'll be there tomorrow.
That's really ironic, because I'm a bit like that myself. I mean, my wife's very keen for me to find a job, but I'm not sure that I should do a job. I'm really playing the field. I'm checking out a few options at the moment.
Yeah, but I think you missed what I'm saying. I'm not that I don't want to come, or that I don't think today I'm just not into it, so I don't think I'll go. Some days I'm too sick. I can't get up.
Well,
some days I'm strong like a bull. I can pick you up and carry you down the road. But there's some days I couldn't carry a jacket.
Is that right?
Everybody I know that has got sick like me 8 years ago when I first got sick, they're dead now.
Oh, dear. You live around here?
Well, actually, I live over there on the blue thing. I've got a lot of blankets under there, a lot of quilts.
I'm supposed to pick up some milk for my kids' breakfast.
No time for Felipe.
But I'll catch you around anyway.
Okay, hey,
very
good
nice
meeting
to meet you, Ed.
Yeah, and you know, I'm serious about that. I'm very interested in something.
Okay,
like
I'll tell my wife.
Okay, bet.
Not that.
So Ed, the homeless guy, is a real homeless guy living on the street. And Simon it's not scripted at all. Ed just reacts to Simon and what Simon says and the kind of things he does. So in that particular scene, it cuts off there, but Simon goes into the shop to get the milk and then comes out again and says, I'm really sorry, Ed, but I've come out without any money. Could you lend me $2 to buy some milk? And so it goes on with, you know, the local gay hairdressers where he goes and he gets it all wrong and says things that offend people and just doesn't realise what he's doing. And every person is told, you know, don't act, just behave normally with this guy. This English guy is going to come in and just react to him as you would. And that's what happens. So we're going back in December to shoot 2 full episodes.
You mentioned when we were talking about it that you had this and you were thinking, what shall I do it?
Yeah.
And you put it up on YouTube, but you broke it into 3-minute chunks.
We put three-minute chunks up, yeah. Mm-hmm. And people just really responded to it and liked it. So that made me think, well, even though we got knocked back by HBO and the BBC, there's an audience for this and we want to explore ways of presenting, and frankly, if you don't explore different ways of presenting material than traditional broadcasting, you're foolish in today's climate and with the way the world is going. So we're going to make these episodes, and then maybe we'll cut them up into chunks again and put them on a social networking site, or maybe HBO will reconsider and give us a ton of money. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. So I think that is there a view that people can only handle clips? Everything that we've spoken about has been in these smaller segments, and I'm sure a lot of people who are here in the audience are interested in making feature docs and getting those out there to an audience. So yeah, I just want to kind of go down the panel. Is it that there is no traction for feature work? I know that, for instance, a couple of years back, 4-Eyed Monsters did the deal with YouTube, and so that they put their entire feature on there, which, okay, now they had a massive following from their MySpace pages, but that seemed to do okay for them. But there does seem to be this almost kind of reaction that we're not going to put anything that's longer than 5 minutes. That's the standard view.
It's a platform problem. It's a technology problem more than anything else. And iPlayer iPlayer is the place for long form content, and they've nailed it. And that's the place you'll go to. And Kangaroo's coming, and Hulu in the US, is responsible for massive amounts of hour long content being consumed on Bebo. And even YouTube, the experience is a bit crappy. I mean, YouTube is amazing and it's huge and the numbers are phenomenal. But in terms of the quality of the video, it's pretty appalling. Mm. you know, even the Bebo experience you kind of saw there, the viewing area is really small. It's not, and the platform itself, Bebo, is first and foremost a social network. So the average user on Bebo, along with MySpace and Facebook, turns something like, 40 to 100 pages per session. So the dynamic of someone actually stopping for 40 minutes, an hour to watch a long film isn't going to happen on Bebo. YouTube have actually just launched their theater mode. I don't know if you saw that recently, so you can kind of like switch the lights off and watch a slightly bigger player, which is much more kind of conducive to watching longer form content. So it's more of a technology issue, and all the platforms are evolving and changing. You know, Bebo is going to evolve a lot as well.
Mm-hmm. Do you think, how much of this, you said technology, do you think will be solved by, you know, you hear about the last mile, which is basically the hop from your computer screen to your TV screen. And, you know, there's things like the Apple TV, which I've got personally, but you've still got to be a bit geeky to go in there and hack it to get things working.
You have got to be a bit geeky, but I think the point is that, you know, behaviours do change. As, you know, a year ago we didn't have iPlayer, shock horror. And with something like, in our experience, something like the gap year, for example, everyone said, oh, you want each of them to be 3 minutes, 4 minutes. You'll have massive tail off after 4 minutes if you run them. And they do vary in length, and it kind of, sometimes the circumstances are so compelling you want to put up a longer one. Technology allows you now to do that. Our catch-up shows are routinely 15 minutes. And once people get into a habit of going to it in order to see it for what it is, they'll stay for 15 minutes. And initially, when the first 8-minute video on the gap year went up, we kind of looked at it and there was quite a drop-off after 50%. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, you do another one, then you do another one, then you do another one. And then gradually, you know, the drop-off moves to 75% the way through, and then you get your vast majority watching the whole thing. And I'm sure it's all down to habit. And yes, the last mile is critical, and you know, we're all looking forward to that opportunity when we can just sit back on the sofa and our TV is iPlayer. But at the moment, social networking is what it is. A lot of people do it when they're not doing other things. So Facebook, your average time on Facebook is 10 minutes. That's it. You go in to see what people are doing, to tell them what you're doing, consume, 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 log off. You know, that's how it works. That's what it's there for. Mm-hmm. It's not, you don't go to Facebook to watch 45 minutes of content at the moment. That may change.
I think it probably will change. I mean, at the moment, when you look at Bebo, you look at MySpace, you look at Facebook, you kind of think that that's programming made for quite a young demographic. And it was, when MTV came out, it was an MTV generation. Suddenly everybody's channel surfing, you're getting snippets of information thrown at you, bombarded. When we started doing Cape Modern, we said it was like snack TV. We were making programs for an MTV generation on speed, because they've got like 8 browsers open, they're jumping from here to there, to here to there, whatever. But I think what the Village People shows, it's, you know, because you can plug this into your television, you can do it now. I use mine as my DVD player, I also surf the internet on TV. Mm-hmm. It's like, more and more people, more and more age groups, a wider demographic of people are accessing information online. And the taste or the length of time that those people are going to want to sit down and watch something is going to change. You know, middle England will want to gather information and watch television programs that are hosted, hopefully, on social networking sites or other places online, you know? Mm-hmm. Recently we made a bespoke drama for middle England, as it were, for Tunbridge Wells, Daily Mail readers, called Katie & Co. And it's, I don't know if it's worth showing it, but it's one of those things that I think makes you realise that there's a market for things like Village People out there. And I think that market is going to be a market that's going to really appreciate a slightly more longer form programme.
Mm-hmm. Let's have a quick look at Katie & Co. as we've got it here.
See the wealth of a thieving hand as it bangs its fist on the ground we stand. All of its laughter is built on a lie, but somehow it governs us time after time. I want to stand up and accuse this beast and smack its wrist for the tales it speaks, but somehow my voice is too distant to hear and no one is listening in. And I see a red lips for the troubles that we know, but I see a red
I mean,
It's an advert. It's made for Jacob's Creek.
Who was the sponsor for that?
Yeah. Did you notice one?
Oh, yeah.
But I think what
we'll
it does...
We'll sit around a dinner party.
Yeah, I think what we've learned from it and what the people that are paid for have noticed from it is, you know, there's a market out there. Yeah. It's not just those MTV generation kids on speed that want to access information in this way, that want to be entertained in this way. You know, the readership of the Daily Mail that probably couldn't be further away from who I am are engaging with it. They're reading the emails, they're entering the competitions, they're watching the episodes, they're discussing it in the forums on the chat rooms. It's like, you know, this is an exciting place where you can tell stories and, you know, whether it's drama, whether it's documentary drama, I want you all out there to really embrace it and think creatively about what we can do, what we can make, what we can say, and who we can affect, I suppose. Mm-hmm. And the Village People is a hell of a lot better than Katie and Co. from the small clip that I've seen there as well. So I'm sure you won't have any problem finding a sponsor or a market for it.
Well, I'm sure we'll find a market. And initially, I was a bit worried about who we'd find as a market, because there's this common misconception that the only people who watch stuff online are 14-year-olds, and of course they're not. I mean, you're absolutely right. If you're doing stuff for the Daily Mail, then there's a huge demographic out there who are computer literate and plugged into these things. So, it's something that you should embrace and not think it's just for kids.
Mm-hmm. I suppose the balance between, you know, for instance, Cape Modern and, you know, there as we saw, when you've got a sponsor on board and if you're doing product placement, the balance between creativity and getting those products in there, how hard is that battle? And as well, into you as well, yeah. Right? Can you do that with documentary?
I mean, the long way round, I think, shows that BMW have a very big presence in the making of that program. Mm-hmm. I think you can get products into program in the way that was said earlier by matching the product that you're going to integrate into the piece of film that you're going to make in a natural way. I mean, we made a drama documentary on snowboarders, so it was easy to get Oakley to sponsor it and it to feel natural. I think if you're making something with some guys on a bike, if they're riding a BMW bike and you see that badge the whole time, it's just going to feel part of the natural kind of backdrop or, you know, part of the naturalness of the program. So I think, yeah, in the beginning we made some faux pas. There were too many Tampax adverts going on in Cape Modern, Cadbury's cream eggs, Toyota, Ego, actual adverts happening in 4 minutes of programming. But I think you make those mistakes and you kind of like learn from them, and then you just realize it's the same as any other traditional program format. I was reading today that Coronation Street are doing a part of a whole campaign, Best of British campaign, where they've licensed out their image, their cast, their stars, their whole thing to basically promote a number of different products that their program makers believe are Best of British. I'm sure that decision was made by who's got the most amount of money. So it's not like a new form of making programs. It's like you need money from somewhere. So, you know, less encourage them to spend it.
I think the other thing as well, if you were trying to get into this kind of content providing, if you're uncomfortable with, you know, that kind of naked kind of commercial sponsorship, then you mentioned the long way around, but that was also, connected to UNICEF. And there are a lot of charities who'd be willing to get involved in stuff like this. And I just made a film earlier this year for UNICEF, because I do film poems and documentary musicals, a film poem is perfect for, you know, short thing. So I did a 3-minute film for UNICEF about shot in Rwanda, about transmission of HIV from mothers to children. It was a kind of information film. Gwyneth Paltrow narrated it, and it's UNICEF put it on the website, and there were links all over the place to it, and it's had thousands, millions of hits. So it's that's another way of doing it, to kind of talk to charities.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The examples that we've been speaking of mainly to do with social networks have been programs that have been produced for the social networks and are hosted by the social networks. But I wanted to ask about, for people, you know, that's going to be a small majority of the filmmakers. There's only going to be a certain amount of filmmakers that you guys are going to talk to, that you're going to commission to make these programs. But how can people who want to create their own material and upload it somewhere then utilize that massive social network audience to send them to their film? Because, you know, occasionally you'll see a film that will go out and they'll say, you know, join our social networks for this film, but how many social networks are you really going to join? You know, every time you create a film, you can't create a whole social network. So how do people effectively tap into, say, something like Bebo to bring that audience to them?
Yeah, I think it's more than just about the content, the quality of content. Great content will obviously shine through, as we saw with Village People. I don't know if that got promotion or anything, which just got discovered and grew virally. But on any of these social media platforms, the key is really kind of community engagement. And it's really basic, simple stuff. So, you know, you don't need to invest a lot of money, but it's time and effort. So even if you have like a small idea, just kind of talk about it, put it on YouTube, Bebo, or Facebook, create a group. And then anytime someone sort of like comments or reaches out in any of those spaces and leaves a message, just immediately get back to them and respond to them publicly. You know, that I always use this example of this incredible, she's a makeup artist, her name's Lauren. I don't know if any of you have kind of followed her. She's a YouTube star. Her YouTube sort of persona is Panchea81, and she's a single mum from South Shields. She wakes up in the morning and she does these eye makeup videos. You know, they're just done in her sitting room. She does her best with the lighting and that sort of thing, but it's, you know, it doesn't cost anything to put up. And you have Max Factor on YouTube and all of these kind of big brands who just kind of say, you know, this, our content's great, it should do really well. And she destroys all of them in terms of the number of subscribers she has, and each of her videos kind of blasts through 500,000 streams. And so we were, you know, chatting to her backwards and forwards on the phone, saying, you know, how the hell are you so popular? I mean, like, the videos are cool, but, you know, they're not like that, like, shattering. And you know, I asked her, you know, do you get messages and comments on YouTube? And she said, yeah, I get hundreds and hundreds a day. I said, well, what do you do? She said, she responds to every single one of them. And it's kind of like a light went on, and that's the kind of key. And when we look at the commissions that we do on Bebo, what we look for is kind of how is audience participation kind of, and interaction part of the narrative and the storyline. And it's the simplest thing, but it's really the most powerful.
Mm-hmm. Is that calling for, you know, almost a role, a new producer role, which is, you know, the producer who just stays on top of the online?
Well, you there guys had Jonathan, didn't you?
There are those people now. I mean, you know. Especially as campaigns get bigger and more people come and watch your stuff, all those people are commenting. I mean, you know, they're actually involved in the entertainment that you're creating in a completely different way. That, you know, ARG exists now, alternative reality gaming. So some of the shows that you make are actually games as well for the audience to come and get involved with. Live events, competitions, giveaways, starring roles are all things like that we use in drama to kind of like really engage with that community. And yeah, there's a whole different range of production team and staff that you need now to look after a very big campaign.
Yeah, I mean, you know, from a, you know, your documentary makers, I mean, the audiences are out there online. Whatever it is that you're passionate about, whatever it is that the story you want to tell about the cause, the campaign, whatever it might be, like, you'll find people online. They might not be on Bebo, they might not be on Facebook, but there'll be communities out there who are passionate about the stuff that you want to talk about. You just got to get out there and kind of embrace them and use them to tap into them, get them to talk about what you're doing as well.
I mean, occasionally you will get the surprise hit. That clip where at the very beginning that we saw, that face bloke one, was one of ours that was part of a comedy show we did for BBC Three. And that's the exception rather than the rule. And I think particularly with non-comedy, you know, we've all moved on beyond the performing dog clip, but it's still comedy is what interests people most. It's like, have you seen that? Ping, 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 ping. But you were talking about creating a new role. I mean, we do have, in fact, the same person who worked on Cape Modern, a guy who's like a community producer, if you like, and that's what he does. Mm-hmm. He's checking comments, he's responding to comments, he's stimulating discussion. So if it goes a bit quiet...
He's forgotten who he is, I think, nowadays as well, because he has to take on so many different roles and be so many different characters in different shows that he does.
So many different profile names.
Yep. Okay, so it's fine that once you've created your work, there are ways for you to get out there and to reach an audience and, you know, stay on top of your comments. That's a way that you can build audience and build a community around it. But we've still got this massive problem, and Brian, I'm sure you're quite aware of this, of if nobody's commissioning you, how do you, you know, there's some documentaries that you can do for nothing, but there's quite a lot of stories that can't be told unless you get that initial seed funding. So how do people get over that hump? Because if you don't make it, no one's ever going to see it.
I think that's unfortunately still a really difficult thing to deal with. That, you know, you can, obviously there are commissions. There are five terrestrial channels on the run in the UK who are all commissioned documentaries. Unfortunately, and one of the reasons why I've started to explore different ways of doing things, I think unfortunately there's less demand from those broadcasters for really challenging, interesting stuff. And I think the other trend that's quite disturbing in broadcasting is that the power to commission, the power to make big decisions is concentrated in fewer and fewer hands. So there aren't as many people who are able to commission, who are able to engage in ideas and to do creative things. So in effect, it's getting tougher if you want to make challenging, interesting work, I think. And maybe this is the way to do it. Maybe it is to go out with a camera, do something very, very cheap, and try and do it as well as you can, and then get people to see it, and then to say, you know, we'll commission this, we'll put some money into it, from whatever source that is, whether it's a broadcaster, an advertiser, a charity, or whoever. I don't know. Obviously, you know, there will still be cutting edge, there will still be true stories, there will still be all the strands that we have, but I think we should all be really looking at tapping into different alternative sources of funding and alternative sources of showing the work.
But you have to get out there and do it in the first place, which is exactly what you've done, which is amazing. And to bring that Lauren, that eye makeup girl, full circle, she's never left the UK. An agency from New York got in touch with her. They flew her to New York about a month ago, and she's launching her own cosmetics range for Christmas. Unbelievable.
There you go. So the money's in makeup there. I'd like to throw it out to the floor. We've covered quite a lot of areas. I'm sure that you guys have got a lot of questions. If you can wait, because it's being recorded, so if you can wait until a microphone comes to you so that it'll actually get picked up, that'll be great.
8 sort of shows next year, but we will fund them. The production, the show won't go into production until a large portion of the production budget's been covered by brand sponsorship. And the reason we choose those productions in the first place is there's a number of kind of different criteria. The first is this whole telling a story in a new way. All stories have been told, but how can we bring a story to our users in a new way? How can the audience participate and be involved in that story? And then finally, the other thing we have to look for is how can brands be involved and be part of that story? That's the kind of three things we need to look for.
And you help find the sponsorship?
I beg your pardon?
You help production company find the sponsorship, or is it?
Yeah, that's what we do. We have 3 salespeople at Bebo, 4 now, and that's what they do is they sell branded content around the shows that we get behind.
Thank you.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, over there at the back.
Can you just talk a little bit more, though, about these relationships with the sponsors and how you develop these relationships? And are you going to them with pilots, or are you going to them with much more developed content? At sort of what stage are you going to them?
I'll answer that one, yeah, if you want. On the gap here, because it was a brand new concept, we basically produced a promo where we sold the idea. So we just said, this is what we want to do. And so you bring Bebo, the platform, the experience of Cape Modern, with Endemol, big global production company, bring the two together, this is what we want to do, bish, bash, bosh, and you kind of do a promo that reflects the aspiration of the series and the values, the brand values. So it's young, it's kind of cool, and it's interesting, and it's diverse, and, you know, it got very, very, very good response from agencies. And it's an area, you know, I've never done that before. You know, I'm from, you know, I do what you guys do. And it's kind of, you know, used to be cap in hand to commissioning editors and then sit and argue for months about the budget. And now it was, you sell the program up front in a very much more blatantly commercial way. They sit down and they say to the Bebo guys, what do we get? Then you have an argument about media value and all the rest of it, because that is more difficult to measure than, you know, your straightforward overnights or viewing figures from television. And then they make a commercial decision as to whether it fits in with their campaign, whether it's worth it. And then, you know, sign on the dotted line.
I would like to add and also probably make you all feel a little bit better about the fact that you can go out there and get money on your own if you want to. After Cape Modern, we thought that we wanted to make another show, which we made called Conquering Demons. I mean, a friend of a friend knew a friend over at Oakley. We walked in, and we were a small indie set. They gave us, you know, a bag of chips, some crisps, and some free Oakley clothes, and said, "Hey, we've got a chalet in Morzine. Why don't you go and do that thing that you were talking to us about a couple of months ago?" We went over, we shot it. It cost hardly anything for us to actually shoot. It raised their brand awareness by 30%, so next year's commission is going to be a lot bigger. So it's like, you know, even without necessarily, and this is just to encourage you all, even without necessarily the weight of the sales team or, you know, the behemoth that is, you know, Endemol, it's you can go out there on your own and you can go and find some little bits of money and make something, and lovely people like Dana will support you and get it out there and make sure people see it. So there are those opportunities as well. So don't feel that it's like one of those things that's completely sewn up and you can't have any creativity or find a sponsor. Go and talk to the brand. If you think it fits your product, go and have a little word in their ear. They might throw you a couple of grand. You might make something special and you might do it again the next year.
I'd just like to add as well, you know, there are places online such as Revision 3. Now, I know Revision 3 had job cuts recently, but that's just the economic climate. And they're currently doing a thing which is Revision 3 Beta, and they're looking for program ideas. A lot of their shows, they'll have like tech shows and, you know, say a cooking based show. They do Dig Nation and the Dig Reel, so I don't know if any of you guys know Dig, but they're actively out there looking for content. And so if you've got a program idea, they're, I suppose, a new form of commissioner. So you can go and approach someone like Revision 3, or again, shoot a little pilot that is, you know, that is going to get across the spirit of what it is that you want, and get in contact with them, because there are people who are actively looking for this stuff. We've got another question over there, let me go through.
This one's to Brian. I just wanted to ask you a bit more about Village People.
Yeah.
Am I clear that ideally you'd have liked to have made this as a documentary series for a television channel? Or do you now feel that by breaking it up into these bite-sized lumps and then putting it out as and when, that you've got an opportunity for some kind of interaction that you wouldn't have had otherwise?
I think initially I just went with a camera to shoot something and then see what we could make of it. And then I did try to sell it as a, to get a broadcast commission to make 6 half-hours or, you know, however many we could get. Obviously, the more the better. And then when, you know, people were reacting to it enthusiastically from broadcasters, but because broadcasters like everything, you know, defined in a box, they weren't quite sure what it was. So that's when I started to think about it in a different way, and that's when I put it onto YouTube. Now, I would still be delighted if we go and shoot, you know, a load more material in December. I'd still be delighted if a broadcaster like HBO came back and said, "Yeah, we love it, we want to buy it, we'll buy 12 episodes, that would be fantastic." But I'm keeping a really open mind about it. You know, I'll shoot it in such a way that it can be cut into smaller chunks, put on the net, or be made more long form. I'll just see what happens with it.
Partly my reason for asking is, I don't know if you're aware of something called Wife in the North, which is a blog that has now become a book, which is basically the diary a woman kept of moving to the country.
Okay.
And I was just thinking about the kind of the way in which the relationship seems to play out between the husband and wife there.
Yeah.
That clearly there's a very interesting dynamic that I can certainly identify with, and I'm sure that other people in the room might be able to. That you know, the freelance life versus the kind of proper job. That actually, you know, what newspapers and other media do with a story like that is, you know, you can send in your views. You know, you can interact with the people and actually kind of advise. I mean, is that something that's on your agenda at all?
I'll explore all sorts of. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to come here today was to meet people who can, because I don't know much about all this. To meet people who can help me and talk to me about stuff like that. But yeah, I'd kind of explore all sorts of different things we can do with it. Be very happy to do that, to kind of get him doing some blog, get her doing some blog, you know, just make it a more 360-degree experience for people who want to kind of find out about them. You know, who can give him advice or her advice on how to deal with him or, you know, whatever it would be. Be happy to embrace the whole thing.
Yeah, question there.
Hi, this is a question for Dan. Rather than commission, do you ever get behind the filmmakers that exist on Bebo kind of editorially to give them a bit of a push? Like, is there like anywhere on the homepage that you shout about them?
In terms of stuff that we commission or just generally across those other 500 partners?
Rather than commissioning, I just mean because the filmmakers exist within Bebo. So is there a way that the content's there that you can shout about it and just give them an editorial push just to kind of say, this looks really good. You guys should check this out.
Yeah, completely. And it's something that we need to do more of. But we do have the homepage, and it gets a lot of traffic. I just need to know about these things, and then we can, we're not short of inventory to kind of to push stuff. But yeah, we can absolutely do that. And that's what we do with the open media platform. So we don't commission that content. People come to us with that, with a couple of episodes, maybe a pilot broken down into a few parts. And you know, what I can certainly say is to anyone here, I'll gladly give it a bit of a spotlight. But you have to understand that a bit of promotion is really only 5% of the success factor. The bulk of it comes down to how you, once you have a bit of a running start, what you then do with those eyeballs and those people who've come to the page. That's the key thing.
Okay, any more questions? Yeah.
Sorry, I think I'm still slightly grappling with the difference between working only with Bebo and then just creating content that could be used on all the different platforms.
Yeah, so I mean, Cape Modern was on YouTube, it was right. On Virgin Atlantic, it was on Daily Motion. The key thing is to know who the audience are on these different digital platforms, and then to think about, you understand your content better than we at Bebo do, and you'll know that if the content's relevant for a 16-year-old or not. And then it's to really engage with those platforms and embrace them and get involved with the people who are on those platforms, the audience in those places.
And then the last thing, as far as the sponsors is concerned, Do you think that they are more akin to sort of knowing that Bebo are going to massively position this and therefore that's what they're going to go for, or would they be more interested, I don't know, to say, well, actually, this is something that works on a lot of different social networking sites.
I think the brands just want eyeballs. They just want to see success. Yeah. So they don't care if it's Bebo or not. They just want to make sure that they get some eyeballs.
I think the thing to remember is that as there's been a shift in traditional television, as we refer to it, so not that long ago, you would get a commission from a broadcaster. That broadcaster owned the rights to that program. Now you're in a situation where they're licensing it. They license it from you, the rights holder. There may be a period of exclusivity, a period of holdback before you can go to any other networks, stations, platforms, whatever. The same is true dealing online. It's just that it's up to you to decide on your period of exclusivity. I mean, does it serve our joint purpose for the gap year to immediately be available on YouTube? That's a very valid question to ask, and one that we've said yes. It's on iTunes, it's on YouTube, it's on MySpace, it's everywhere. The point is to get it out there. We want to establish, brand is a good and a bad word. Brand implies it's a commercial commodity and something that, we all want to hide behind and make lots of money out of. Yes, clearly we do, but at the same time, if you don't know about it, some of the best comments that we've had have not come necessarily from Bebo, but from other ones, from the kids. That you come back, you get the classic, what is this? And then they go, oh, bloody gap year, it's everywhere in it. And you get that time and time again because it keeps cropping up. And
what
it's fantastic.
What are you saying about our users?
Yeah, yeah. Grammar not a strong point if you go through the comments on Bebo. But the point is, you're in control because you own it and you decide. So it's all up for discussion, but sometimes you want it to be associated with a particular platform, and sometimes you want it to be. I mean, we do stuff with other people that is exclusive to them, and that's a decision taken between us at the time. With the gap here in Bebo, we want as wide an audience, and Bebo's exclusivity is very short because it doesn't need to be long.
It's funny, the last thing I said, one thing that everyone should check out is on YouTube, just do a search for anthropological study of YouTube.
Yeah.
It's a 50-minute long video. You have to watch it. If you're thinking about doing anything online, just check out this video. It's by Professor Michael Esch, and it's just incredible. It'll really give you a huge insight into what's happening with digital content online at the moment. Mm-hmm. Anthropological study of YouTube. Mm-hmm.
Well, there's an argument as well that if you, you know, it's great you can use something like Tube Mogul to send it mm-hmm. out to Vimeo, to YouTube, everywhere. But there's this idea that the things that get picked up the most are the ones that have got the most hits. So if I can see your video on Vimeo and somebody else can also see it on YouTube, those combined hits might be great, but you're not going to get the, oh, wow, that one's had a million views just on YouTube if you had just left it on YouTube solely, which then obviously brings more views to it. And then maybe after you stage it, maybe that is going to work better for you, that you stage it, you release it to YouTube or to Vimeo first, see when those hits start petering out, and then you spread it out. Kind of thing. There's, you know, it's a different way of looking at it. Is it better to send it out to lots of places in one go, or is it better to kind of build momentum in one single place and then release it?
I think you just have to have the resources to be able to manage it wherever you put it. So if you all of these different video hosting sites, they all have community as well. So you need to be able to make sure that you're able to respond to the audience in those places, because ultimately, it's going to help you increase the audience, increase the loyalty of those users, and the number of views that you have. That's the key thing, basically. Yeah, put it everywhere, but manage it in those places. Don't just throw shit at a wall. Yeah. It's not shit. It's amazing stuff. Sorry.
Yeah, I should say as well, if you use something like Tube Mogul, and there are lots of others, the good thing about that is you get stats. And so you can very quickly go in, view your stats, and see where it's getting the most traction, as opposed to you having to manually do that. If you manually upload it to YouTube and then to Vimeo and then, you know, kind of to Rever or wherever else it is, then you've got to kind of go in and dig into that. Whereas Tube Mogul, you get a nice report of what's happening where. So it makes that whole thing of tracking the comments and things like that, makes that a lot easier as well for you if you use something like that. I wanted to just as well, kind of, in case that I'm sure there are some other questions, but I just wanted to get a show of hands as to, you know, who out there uses MySpace and Facebook? Okay.
And Bebo.
Sorry, and Bebo. And Bebo. Okay, and then of you guys who do use that, how many of you have uploaded content to those sites? Okay, so quite a lot of you. Because another thing that I wanted to point out is, all right, how many of you use Twitter, which is, I suppose, the next evolution now, but, yeah, okay, so a lot fewer hands, okay? So a lot of people, what they're using Twitter for, Twitter is basically, if you haven't come across it at all, it's basically like the what am I doing section in Facebook, and that's it, which sounds really pointless initially, but is really, really powerful, and because there's no noise of, you know, you've been bitten by this vampire, do you want to chase him down as a werewolf type thing, okay? It's very, very specific. And what people have been doing on Twitter, for instance, I know a guy who posts on their Life Zero, who's got a program called That Media Show, he had various presenters that he was trying out, and he kind of reached out to the Twitter community of people who were following him to say, look, I want to put a poll up, which of my presenters do you like the best? Okay, and so then he got feedback from, say, 600 people who said, oh, it's this presenter, which wasn't necessarily what he thought was going to what he thought the results were going to be. And then he could use that as a starting off point for him to then improve the show. And other people have done that, where they will produce that one pilot that they're going to maybe send to a commissioner. Okay, but before they do that, they reach out to I don't even know what the multiple name is for Twitterers, okay? But they reach out to the Twitterverse, yeah? They reach out to those guys to say, well, what elements did you or didn't you like about this show? They come back with various comments, and then obviously, you know, you've got to have your filter. You know, there's people who are always going to say something positive, people who are always going to say something negative, and the truth is somewhere in between that. Then take those comments, revise the promo, and then go and approach the commissioners and the people that you want to partner with you after you've had, you know, several people bashing on this program, really, so that you can kind of really, really refine it. Okay. So, yeah, are there any more questions, really? I just wanted to mention that in case nobody had thought of doing that with their work. Oh, one over there.
Hi, guys. I've just general frustration at uploading videos, you know, for the last few years, and you see, there's a great production company called Journeyman Pictures, who are true documentaries only, and they've just done a deal with YouTube, Well, the deal was done about 6 months ago where they get paid per click. Every time someone watches a video on YouTube, Journeyman Pictures gets some money. Now, this, I've always been waiting, you know, because you put videos up and I've kind of been waiting for, you know, this to filter down to just general users. I mean, do you think this is ever going to happen? Do you think we're ever, as filmmakers, as storytellers, we're ever going to get a little something for these millions of clicks that happen and all this advertising dollars and everything like that? You know, I mean, and obviously I'm not expecting you to say yes, but it would, you know, I just to open it up.
Basically. I just want to point one, I laughed the other day when a friend of mine came in. He's relaunching Banzai, I think that's the right way of saying it, on and they relaunched it on MySpace. Now, they were in a situation where they benefited from the click-through revenue stream, this kind of thing that nobody knows how much money they're actually making. That was an RDF commission, and they were very pleased when they got their check through the other day for £250. So if you imagine like how much traffic that portal was actually seeing, that show, that channel, that even if you are, you know, even if it is going to really filter down to you, the actual revenue that's going to come to you is not going to be substantial, or in my experience. Mm-hmm.
Although I'd like to point the Four-Eyed Monsters, and again, you know, in the larger share of things, I'm sure it wasn't massive, but they made a deal when they did that YouTube thing for their feature to go on there. They made a deal with Spout, so there was a kind of a pre-roll before you could watch the film from Aaron and Susan's kind of saying, look, if you go up and sign up to Spout, which isn't going to cost you anything, so they need to go up and sign on to Spout, and they're a kind of an indie film site. For every user that signs up, we get a dollar, and there was a cap at 100,000. I'm not sure if 100,000 did it in the end. I think it might have been 80,000. But they managed to make that deal because they had the followers from MySpace, and they basically were saying, okay, that's the deal that they made with Spout, so everyone who went and signed up, they got a dollar kind of thing, and they got, you know, a good 80 grand or something like that. So there are ways to do it.
I think, you know, what Gav just said is the important thing. There is revenue to be had at the moment. There's just not a lot of it, but the idea is you're not just occupying a 49-minute slot on a Wednesday night somewhere. It's up there and it's constant. And obviously for, you know, content-rich companies, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on at the moment about video, you know, digital rights and digital archive and how to monetize your back catalog, blah, blah, blah. And you just go, if you do get more and more and more stuff up there, and it's dripping, and it's pennies, and it's small amounts of money, and then, yeah, okay, you get 250 quid, but that 250 becomes 1,000, and then 1,000 becomes 2, and then there is money to be had. Whether that's money to be made, I think is a different question, but in due course, yes, it will. Don't give up.
You mentioned in digital rights there, actually. I suppose, Brian, I want to come to you. How worried are you of, because with you guys, you've already kind of made the deals, so the money's already there, if you see what I mean. You've made the product placement deals. But for, like, you know, for yeah, your village people, you know, how worried are you of digital rights management, like, that, you know, that somebody is just going to take your film, you know, rip it off YouTube, play it somewhere else, and maybe they've got ads on their site and they're making money off your content?
It's not something I've thought about, to be honest. I guess you can't stop people doing that, and I don't really have too many concerns about it. I mean, before I assigned any rights to anybody and before we you know, did any kind of deal, it'd obviously get heavily lawyered and contracts would be signed. But in terms of people just stealing it, well, go ahead.
Stealing
means more people are seeing it. Mm-hmm.
There are different digital rights management systems on different platforms, and if you register as a channel, then if your registered content goes up on that platform, every time it is used, you get the click, and then you get the pennies that turn into the 250s that turn into the... So it's...
That's what I needed to know.
The technology is there, but again, you've got to know how to apply it and who's got it.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Who wants a drink? Should we go?
Yeah. So look, I'd like to thank the panel here. So Richard, Danielle, Brian, and Gav, and I'm Marbelle, which I think I forgot to say at the very beginning, which is not very useful at all. I'd also like to point out that Brian, actually, can you introduce, you've got a film playing, haven't you?
Those of you who've scoured your program for the festival may have noticed that Sunday morning, 11:45, it's listed as secret screening, and I can reveal, it's not really a secret anymore, but it's a new film I've made called Climate of Change. It's a film about the environment, which has been broadcast, been screened, 11:45 Sunday morning, if you're here.
Brilliant. So yeah, if I could get a round of applause for the panel. Thank you all for coming.